that you joined us this evening. We are gearing up for a great evening. We're excited about all the things that are in store and the services tonight. We're looking forward to God's help. But we've already had a great day today. We've had great services. Cameron, tell us about some things that have happened today.
Oh, it's been a wonderful day here at IHC. You know, one of my favorite things in the world is just coming into the convention center and seeing that buzz of people. And it feels like it's been that way all day long. It's sprinkled a little bit throughout the day, so I feel like...
A little bit. Well, it's sprinkled a lot.
A lot of it, yeah. I definitely used my umbrella a couple times. But anyways, it feels like we're all in the convention center. It's just neat to see people that you don't normally get to see from all over the country. And so it's been wonderful. I was just thinking about the keynote address that happened here at 2:45 this afternoon. David Fulton did a wonderful job, and hearing great things from that service. Now, I was talking with you a little earlier. You were in the Time of Discovery service.
I was. Time of Discovery service is always a highlight. It's always a great time. We had a great crowd today, over 500 young people.
Wow.
And just a great service. God really helped us. We had musical numbers from some of our young people. We had a couple special songs from our Bible colleges. And then Tom Sanders gave a wonderful message to our young people about that space between the prayer we pray, asking for God's help, whether it be in our life, whether it be in our spiritual walk, and God's answer, and the difficulty of maintaining faith and trusting God in that area between praying the prayer and trusting God for the answer. And that was an excellent service. That will be added to our archives. You can go back and listen to that. But it was a great service. God helped. And there were seekers at the altar in that service. And what a great, great service that was.
That's wonderful. Yeah, Time of Discovery is always so fun. Yeah. You know, Brother Durst and the whole Time of Discovery team, they do everything they can just to make it a blast. And I was loving when I was there listening to everything that was going on, and they were doing these giveaways.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think today they gave away different gift cards for the different young people.
That's right.
And are they doing different kinds of giveaways all throughout the week?
So they did giveaways today, and then in the 10 a.m. service on Thursday, we're going to have a lot of giveaways. That's kind of the service where we do it mostly. And we're going to be giving away several bicycles donated by Durst Cycle. We're giving away all sorts of gift cards and Time Discovery merchandise, all sorts of things. And for those young people that are here for the Time of Discovery at IHC, you won't want to miss that service, 10 a.m. on Thursday.
That's great. I know one of my young people, Reagan Schaefer, he got a gift card.
He did.
Can't wait for him to take me out next week.
But we'll make him do that.
Yeah, yeah, that's
for sure.
Right.
He needs to.
So still coming up at 6 o'clock, we have the front lines of the harvest.
Right.
Benjamin McDowell is going to be speaking during that time. And so we're really looking forward to what he's going to be talking about in the evening service. And then Allegheny Wesleyan College is to be bringing the music. And they always do a phenomenal job.
Yeah.
Looking forward to all that. And then what's happening at 7:15?
So 7:15 is our evangelistic service. And I believe God's Bible School and College and choir will be favoring us with some special numbers in song, both with their symphonic wind orchestra and string orchestra and their choir. And we look forward to their ministry in that regard. But we're also looking forward to a message from Jeremy Fuller. He'll be bringing the main message in the evangelistic service, and we look forward to his ministry, of course, tonight. Looking on then towards tomorrow, there's all sorts of things going on tomorrow, starting at 9:15. There's a Bible study with John Whitaker, a revival rally at 10:15 with Keith Ledford, and then all throughout the day, there are going to be wonderful services, anointed singing. You won't want to miss it. You'll want to tune in, not just tonight, but you'll want to tune in all day tomorrow and worship with us throughout the day.
Absolutely.
Where all can they listen to the live stream? I know we're possibly listening on ihconvention.com. Where else can they listen, tune into the live stream?
So probably the primary, you're right, is ihconvention.com. You could also go to IHC Interchurch Holiness Convention on YouTube, and you can see live on there as well. And then also the Facebook page. The Facebook page is probably my favorite way to tune in. You get to... you can listen there. Usually the stream is pretty clear. And then you can also comment. And we would love to have you comment on that Facebook stream, where you're listening from.
Right.
And we'd love to interact with you that way. If you do go to the ihconvention.com, you'll see different things on there. Specifically, you can see different ways to give. And there's multiple ways that they've looked at trying to set all that up. Lots of ways you can do online. One of my favorite ways is through Cash App. Cash App, I use Cash App all the time.
Well, of course, you're a young whippersnapper.
I'm just a young yeah, that's right.
So you give on Cash App, but what are some of the other ways? They can give PayPal, right?
They can give to PayPal, right? PayPal, and that will be on the website. They can also give, I don't know, check. You can give cash by carrier pigeon.
We accept all sorts of donations.
Yeah.
With the rising prices and with the cost of living going up, we understand that it's difficult for everyone to make ends meet. But we want to see God's work go forward here at IHC, and we're trusting God to provide the need. And we encourage you, if you are able to give, if God moves on your heart to give, we challenge you to give as you're able. And you can give through all of these ways that we mentioned. And you can also find an address on ihconvention.com, and you can give through check by mailing your checks to that address.
One of the interesting things that's been going on for IHC this year is they've had these different invitations to welcome that everybody can get throughout the convention. They can actually pass it out to the people in Gatlinburg. So if you've ever been to Gatlinburg, you know it's a busy place. People are crowded on the streets, and lots of people that could hear the gospel through IHC.
Right.
And so there's different invitation cards that we've been passing out all around Gatlinburg. I think it's going to be a really neat thing. In fact, I've already seen some people that have been walking through the convention center. I wander through those cards.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank the Lord for that. And I know many of you watching are not able to be here and experience kind of the full IH convention experience.
Yeah.
But for those who are not able to be here, there are some really interesting things going on around the convention center outside of what perhaps you see on the live stream. We've got all sorts of vendors and booths, and one of my favorite booths, Cameron, is the coffee booth. Right outside the studio here, there is a booth that is selling all sorts of both whole bean and ground coffees. I love stopping by there for samples. What are some booths you've seen, Cameron, that you found interesting?
Oh, I was just walking through the different booths right before I came here, actually. One of the ones I thought was interesting, I saw a Culture Changers booth.
Oh, okay.
And it's a new organization helping empower parents as they're going through different decisions with their schooling and and things of that nature. And so I think that's a really neat thing. What's some things that you've seen?
Well, I haven't seen this myself, but I was told by a reliable source that one of our Bible colleges, I believe Union Bible College, has a spot at their booth where occasionally throughout the day, they have a screen with their logo that goes off and starts changing colors, and the first person to arrive at that booth gets free merchandise from UBC. And so there's all sorts of exciting things.
Wow.
And if you haven't attended the IH Convention here at Gatlinburg yet, you need to make plans next year to do that. It's a really, really exciting atmosphere. And we're looking forward tonight to a wonderful service. And all of the exciting things around are wonderful, but most important is God's presence in the service.
Yep.
We're looking forward to it, and we're trusting God to help us tonight. Stay tuned. You won't want to miss the service this evening. Thanks for watching.
God bless.
This is IHC 24/7. Your prayers and support are helping us in our mission to spread the message of holiness around the world. It is our joy to bring you inspiring messages, uplifting music, and the Word of God every day. We hope you will continue to join us as we journey together in faith and hope. Thank you for making IHC 24/7 a part of your day.
Hey everybody, we are honored to have you in Tennessee. You have been the hands and feet of Jesus in your local communities, and I'm grateful for your work and the work of your churches to share the gospel and make families and communities across the nation stronger. Maria and I pray that this time of fellowship will encourage you, and we pray God's richest blessings over you in the years to come.
Allegheny Wesleyan College for that wonderful music. Did you enjoy that tonight? Say amen. Amen. It's the 6 o'clock front line to the harvest service, and we appreciate you coming in to the service this evening. I'm going to ask you to stand if you would. Brother Garen Wolf is coming to lead us in the singing. Let's sing like holiness people can sing. Amen.
145. All right, let's turn to page 145. Holiness forevermore. We're only going to sing one, so we got to do it right the first time. All right, here we go.
There's a blessed and triumphant song, holiness forevermore. It is by the good and true.
Yeah. Amen. It's my privilege to welcome you to this special Front Lines of the Harvest service this evening. Tonight I want us to think specifically about the global harvest and what Jesus wants us, his church, to do about it. In John 4:35, Jesus said to his disciples, "Say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh the harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already for harvest." There are several key things to note about the global spiritual harvest. First of all, the harvest is ready. I'm not a farmer, but I know some of you are or have worked on farms, and I can only imagine the sense of urgency when a farmer knows his crops are ready now to be harvested and brought in. And I believe Jesus wants us to cultivate a similar sense of urgency. He asks his followers, "Don't you say that there are still 4 months until the harvest?" Well, you're mistaken. The harvest is now. Don't push it off until later. Don't sit around thinking that there is plenty of time to reach the lost. Because the thing about a harvest is that if you don't get it in while it's ripe, it's lost forever. Later is too late. The great missionary to Africa, Robert Moffat, said, "We shall have all eternity in which to celebrate our victories, but we have only one swift hour before the sunset in which to win them." Not only is the harvest ready, the harvest is also abundant. The statistics are staggering. Today, more than 1 out of 3 people, 1 out of 3 people in the world, more than that, have never, ever heard the gospel message. The majority of these are in unreached, or these unreached people live in countries between 10 degrees and 40 degrees north of the equator in what missiologists call the 1040 window. Unreached people and places are those among whom Christ is largely unknown and the church is relatively insufficient to make Christ known in the broader population without outside help. Missionaries are desperately needed to reach these lost groups. In the days we spend at IH Convention here in Gatlinburg, hundreds of thousands of people around the world will slip into eternity, and so many of them will have never even had the chance to hear the gospel. Ladies and gentlemen, the harvest is great. It's abundant. It's plentiful. But thirdly, the harvest is valuable. It's people. It's souls. It's friends and family. Jesus illustrated the extreme value of just one individual in the parable of the shepherd leaving his 99 sheep in search of one which was lost. I just mentioned large numbers, and perhaps it's difficult to wrap our minds around them, but each one of those people is worth the world to Christ. He would have given his life, his all, for just one. One like Becker Alca from Lima, Peru. Just 18 miles from where I live in Hope Sound, Florida, is a thoroughbred horse training facility named Payson Park. Horses from all over the world are trained there, which means there are hundreds of people, of workers, from all over the world who are working with those horses. In fact, probably at least 30 countries are currently represented there this season. Almost 2 years ago, God opened doors for Eddie Santiago, the pastor of the HIM Spanish Church in Hope Sound, to begin ministering as chaplain at Payson Park. And 4 days ago, Eddie sent a text about Becker Alca. Becker arrived at Payson Park in January of this year, and just this past Thursday afternoon, Becker gave his heart to our loving Savior. Chaplain Eddie has been working closely with him in recent weeks, and Becker is excited to learn more about the Bible and about Jesus. And do you know what the Bible tells us? This past Thursday, the hosts of heaven stood up and celebrated with great rejoicings right along with Becker when he gave his heart to Christ. And I say praise God, because the harvest, each soul, is truly valuable. Across the last many decades, the people and churches of the holiness movement have responded to Christ's call to reap the ready harvest. And tonight, God is using you, this Gatlinburg Convention crowd, to reach the nations for Christ. Scattered across this congregation are a group of my heroes, men and women and children who have answered the call of God to go and make disciples around the globe among all the nations. They couldn't do so. They couldn't do so without your support, your sacrificial giving, and your prayers. I've asked several of those individuals involved in the front lines of the global harvest from different regions around the world to come share tonight how God is at work and how souls are being transformed. As they speak, rejoice with them, but also open your heart. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal more clearly what role He wants you to play in the Great Commission. The ripened harvest is all around us. We each must be busy about reaching the lost.
It certainly is a privilege to speak to you tonight. My name is Kent Engel, and it's my joy to share a little bit about what God is doing in northern British Columbia, Canada, in a little town called Chetwynd. We moved to BC in 2018. We were excited to be joining the ministry of my wife Laura's parents, brother and sister Carveth. God has been using them there in the work for over the past 30 years. Chetwynd is a small town, largely occupied by transient workers in the forestry and sawmills, coal mines, gas and oil industries. And yet, despite its dusty little camp town persona, it seems to be one of the most culturally diverse places that I've ever seen. For example, there's a large community of immigrants from the Philippines, many working frontline services in local fast food venues or hotels. When we made first contact with this local subculture, when we moved right next door to Wenny and Lito. And I remember the first time I stood at the fence in my yard talking to Lito, who was standing on the other side of the fence in his yard. And I was wishing that my wife would come out and help me understand his thick accent. But it didn't take us long to realize that Wenny and Lito were kind people and good neighbors in the most genuine sense of the word. And their two daughters, Kate and Claire, were sweet young girls with kind smiles. And over time, our friendship grew. They invited us to their parties and into their homes. They came into our kitchen and showed us how to make spring rolls and taught us to love Filipino foods. And then they began to introduce us to other members of the Filipino community, and we began to learn about their groups. Recently, they invited us to come to the Catholic Church as one of the families had their baby's christening service. And we met Lou, a quiet Filipino lady, after her husband tragically passed away. And again, we felt the frustration of the cultural gap between our way of trying to love and support and her way of trying to grieve and work through this very difficult time. And honestly, it's still a work in progress, but we know that God is working in the lives and hearts of these dear people. Now, on the flip side, we also have the indigenous peoples that live in the traditional and unceded lands that make up the community of Chetwynd in the Peace River region. And they look at life from a completely different perspective. Their cultural celebrations include references to the Creator, but with the dark undertones of spirit worship. Both the Soto Reservation and the West Moberly Reserve are facing an epidemic of drug and alcohol use. The child abuse and neglect in these nations is heart-wrenching. These are kind and quiet people. They're our neighbors, and yet they're so very lost in sin and darkness. But we're happy to have some of them attending our church and seeing God work in their lives, gloriously saving them from sin and delivering from alcohol addiction. We see them as people for whom Christ died. When you pray for us, pray against the powers of darkness, abuse, and addiction in our First Nations communities. We had been praying that God would give us a family with children in our church, and God answered our prayer. The family was able to immigrate to Chetwynd from Cameroon. The father, the mother, and the five children, they quickly found their way into our homes and hearts. Our church people also responded to them so sweetly. We were able to get them outfitted with heavy winter mitts and coats and snow pants for the long, dark, upcoming winter. And I remember my wife standing in the kitchen and trying to teach Antoinette how to make a loaf of bread. And I remember five-year-old little Solomon standing at the microphone in the Christmas service and proudly saying his memorized piece. And then, just as we felt we were starting to make an inroad, a sad turn of events, an unfaithful marriage situation, and Antoinette, the mom, left the family and went back to Cameroon. Now, this has been very painful for us to watch and difficult to explain to our kids and difficult to know how to minister to these little African immigrant children with hurt written all over their faces. Thankfully, ministry comes in many forms, and so we've found that conversations about basketball, snowmobile rides, hikes in the mountains, and hugs seem to have a way of bridging some of these gaps. And then there's my coworkers. These are guys that have been heavy equipment operators for years, highly skilled, but rough and very lost. I remember standing on the side of the mountain beside the John Deere log processor talking to Bob, and Bob admitted to me that day that he was afraid to die. And I took the opportunity to tell Bob about Jesus and the hope of eternal life. And Bob will likely never attend a church service or an outreach event, and neither will Gord, who sat in his excavator and asked me questions about why bad things happen if there really is a God. And over again, I've come to realize that the front lines of the harvest are often not in our churches and missions, but rather places where you go to work, places where you go to shop, places where your clothes get dirty, and with people that you rub shoulders with while life happens. The beautiful thing about ministry is the fact that whether the lambs that God invites you to feed are from Africa, the indigenous peoples of Canada, the Filipino community, or the coal miners and loggers that make our economy work, love and the message of grace and redemption bridge all of these cultural gaps, and we are seeing God work in amazing ways and do things that we have been unable to do, and we just want to stand here and say, to God be the glory, great things He has done.
Thank you, Kent. Tonight, we have a very special guest, a couple very special guests. One is a missionary statesman, and again, one of my heroes, Brother Raymond Shreve. But also, Brother Jose has come all the way from Chiclayo, Peru, and I would say that he wins the award for the most distance traveled to get here tonight, and it's a privilege to have Brother Jose and Brother Raymond Shreve to share with us tonight.
Que la paz del Señor y la comunión del Espíritu Santo sea con todos vosotros.
May the peace of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you tonight.
Reciban los saludos del Reverendo Iván Rojas de la Cruz, obispo de nuestra Iglesia Evangélica de los Peregrinos del Perú.
I bring you greetings from our national leader, Iván Cruz, who is bishop of our church.
Agradezco infinitamente a Dios en primer lugar, porque me permitió estar aquí para ser parte de esta gloriosa fiesta espiritual.
I thank the Lord first of all for the privilege of being here to enjoy this wonderful spiritual fiesta.
Pero también agradezco a mi amigo Raymond Sweet, a quien quiero mucho y nos conocemos de muchos años.
But I'm also thankful to my friend Raymond Shreve, who has been a friend for many years.
Agradezco asimismo también al comité ejecutivo de la convención que hace posible esta participación nuestra desde el Perú.
And I thank the committee of the convention that's made this possible for us to come from Peru.
Estamos aquí, hermanos amados, con la única expectativa de recibir más del Señor.
We're here only to receive more from the Lord.
De conocer más de su presencia.
To know more about His presence.
De aprender como un niño.
To learn like a child.
Mi corazón y nuestro corazón de la Iglesia de los Peregrinos está ansioso de conocer más de Dios.
And we are anxious, my heart and our church's heart is anxious to know more about God.
Yo tengo la plena convicción que así será. Al término de esta fiesta, la gloria de Dios va a ser grande, se va a repartir en esta reunión.
And I know that in this meeting, in this gathering, the glory of God will manifest itself before this is over with.
La Iglesia de los Peregrinos en el Perú nació en el año 1904. Tiene 120 años de trabajo allá en mi patria.
Our church, the Pilgrim Church of Peru, was born in 2004. It's 120 years old.
Fue el resultado de las misiones de Estados Unidos. Gracias, gracias de todo corazón por haber llevado el Evangelio a mi patria.
It was the product of missions from this country to our country, and we thank God for that.
Hermanos amados, desde ese tiempo la Iglesia de los Peregrinos no ha cesado de trabajar.
And we have not ceased to work from that time till now.
La Iglesia de los Peregrinos está de pie, sigue creyendo que Dios es grande y Dios es fiel en cumplir sus promesas.
We continue to believe that God is great and God is faithful and He keeps His promises.
Creemos en la unidad de la Iglesia y creemos en la unidad del cuerpo de Cristo.
We believe in the unity of the body of Christ, the church of Christ.
Creemos que donde hay dos pueden hacer mejor trabajo.
And we believe that where two are better than one.
Creemos que la gloria de Dios se manifestará más. La iglesia de los peregrinos quiere seguir avanzando, pero también somos conscientes de que no hemos avanzado mucho.
And we want to continue advancing as a church, but we realize we have not advanced as we should.
Tenemos 120 años y somos 300 iglesias, 320 pastores y 10,500 miembros.
We've been in existence for 120 years, but we have 30 churches, 300 churches and 320 pastors.
Consideramos que no hemos hecho mucho.
And we realize we have not really accomplished what we would like to.
Pero vine a decirles en el nombre del Señor y de la Iglesia Evangélica de los Peregrinos del Perú que necesitamos unirnos para hacer una mayor campaña, un mayor avance de la obra de Dios.
But I've come to tell you we realize we need to unite so that we can make a better move forward better for the sake of the gospel.
Gracias por permitirnos ser parte de esta convención, amados hermanos. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much for giving us a part in this convention.
Es mi oración y mi plegaria que esta reunión por primera vez con ustedes sea el inicio de una relación muy especial y muy fraterna.
And it's my prayer that this first encounter between us and the convention and you folks will bring about a real lasting and powerful relationship for time to come.
Gracias por sus oraciones. Estoy seguro que al estar aquí representa la petición de un pueblo, de una nación que tiene hambre por conocer el Evangelio de nuestro Señor Jesucristo.
And you can be assured that our being here, it represents a country that has hunger to know more about the Lord Jesus Christ.
Y de una iglesia que tiene toda la pasión por seguir evangelizando, por seguir haciendo la obra, por seguir ayunando, por seguir vigilando, pero que le hace falta una ayuda más.
And also we represent a church that is going to continue praying and fasting and believing God, but we realize that we need additional help.
Creo rotundamente en lo que dice la palabra de Dios en Eclesiastés capítulo 4 versículo 9, 10 y 12. Lo siguiente: mejores son dos que uno, porque tiene mejor paga de su trabajo, porque si cayere el uno le levantará a su compañero, pero ay del solo, que cuando creyere no habrá segundo que lo levante.
Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe unto him who is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up.
Y si alguno prevaleciere contra uno, dos le resistirán, y cordón de tres dobleces no se romperá pronto.
And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and therefore a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Estoy seguro que la unidad hará que avancemos en Latinoamérica, en toda Sudamérica, en Estados Unidos y en todas las regiones del mundo.
And I'm sure that as we pull together, we will go forward in Latin America and North America, and in fact around the world.
Gracias una vez más por este espacio glorioso. Lo valoro demasiado. Dios les bendiga.
Thank you
Gracias.
Once again for this opportunity,
Gracias.
And I value it highly. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. So this brother has asked us to come to Peru for IHCs among these many churches. Do you think we should go? All right. Well, we're going to go. We already have it on the schedule. And this is what's happening to IHC right now. We're getting calls from around the world. Of course, this year in Papua New Guinea, in Turks and Caicos Islands, Belize, the Cayman Islands, Canada. We were also in Saipan, which is a USA territory, but it's far enough away that it feels like it feels international. Let me just tell you that the highlight of our year was South Korea. Charles and Letty Campbell, Charles and Letty Kalman, and the GBS students got Japan on their heart way before World War II. You may recall that story of how they went and knocked on every door in the country of Japan. When you know history and understand what would happen to Japan soon, that is powerful, that the gospel touched every home. From there, it went to North Korea, and holiness was born in the hearts of people, large holiness movement in Korea. This is prior to communism and prior to the Korean conflict. The nation divided in half now. and holiness churches all across that nation. In 1967, Harold Schmuel, H. Rob French from IHC were invited to go to South Korea to hold holiness conventions. And to, I just read it in the Convention Herald by Brother Schmuel, he wrote this, to discuss the heart of our visit, revival, and the conservation of Bible holiness with standards. Following that, Dale Yoakam went to Korea, where he invested a year or two of his life teaching in the Bible College. This wasn't printed in the Convention Herald. I always kind of wondered what happened. You may remember seeing old editions of the Convention Herald with Brother Schmuel, Brother French, Brother Yoakam on the front cover, going to Korea. We learned that there was a translator error, either intentional or non-intentional, that caused Brother Yoakam to have to leave Korea and come home, no doubt defeated. Now, that's all back in the 1960s. That's before I discovered America. All these years later, they reach out to IHC again to come back. What do you think we should have done? We went back. Dr. McElwain, Melvin Waters, my brother John, myself, we go back to Korea and we are welcomed with open arms. Dr. McElwain is invited to the same college where Brother Yoakam taught so many years ago. And Brother McElwain, it's now a university of 6,500 students. And Brother McElwain is invited to give holiness lectures in this university. And we sat in the president's office. He talked to us all about the history of the holiness movement there, the IHC. He told us that Dr. Yoakam, his book, The Holy Way, is in their curriculum to this day in the university. All of the ministerial students have to read and study Dale Yoakam's The Holy Way. Dale Yoakam is long gone. I doubt he had a clue. But I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that wherever we went in Korea, Dale Yoakam is regarded like we would regard John Wesley. I preached a simple message on entire sanctification in a large city church. Coming to the back foyer, the older pastor, senior pastor, shook my hand. He said, "You preach the same message that Dale Yoakam preached." Everything was Dale Yoakam this, Dale Yoakam that. It reminded me, "They that sow in tears shall reap in joy." And before we left, they said, "We want convention on the schedule every year. You think we ought to go back?" Okay, well, I think we will. You pray for us and keep supporting IHC. We stood on the river bank looking over into North Korea. They know that in North Korea was a large holiness church. All of the church buildings have been seized. Their people are in concentration camps. But they told us they have confidence there's a stronger holiness church in North Korea than in South Korea. South Korea has freedom. South Korea has materialism and worldliness in all of their churches. But the fires of persecution have no doubt preserved the holiness message in North Korea beyond belief. And we prayed on those banks for people I've never met, people you've never met, but are heroes to us all. They suffer for their faith today. Thank you for your support of IHC. We're excited about our first convention in Peru. We're very excited about our first convention in the Philippines soon. We also have a leader from Kenya who will be in this convention this year, representing hundreds and hundreds of churches. The world is opening up to IHC. People want the holiness message. There's a great harvest. They're looking to you. They're looking to you because they believe you still believe it, and you teach it, and I believe you do.
Good evening. My name is Sid Grant, and I'm director of Hope International U.S. Hispanic Ministries. But I'm also involved with a new ministry that God has given us 3 years ago, actually during the COVID years, in the year of 2020. And it is being called PAS. Now, that's a Spanish acronym for Platform of Advancing Holiness. Of course, it doesn't spell out that way in English, but that's what it means in Spanish. And during the COVID years, we were able to minister to several Hispanic pastors by Zoom in Guatemala. And as a result of that, God spoke to me personally about starting a ministry to reach out to the holiness churches in Latin America. And one of the things that, we missionaries go into the different countries, invest a lot of money and time and so forth, and start organizations and so forth. But what we have here in America is a blessing to the holiness movement through the ministry of H. Rob French and H. E. Schmuel and many others. But God has spoke to me that we should do something for the churches in Latin America in regards of trying to bring the holiness churches together in Latin America. Actually, I just heard a number that excited me of 300 churches in Peru. I heard that previously it was 250, but that just confirmed is more than I heard. Because I was doing a little bit of research to find out how many holiness churches there are in Latin America. And I came up with 750 holiness churches. Now with the 50 churches added, that's 800 churches in Latin America. I'm certain there are more than that. So one of the vision is to bring all of these churches together in Latin America to make sure that the message of holiness continues to go forward. So as a result of this 2020 COVID year, open door to go into Latin America, God help us to reach out to all of the leaders, the holiness leaders in Guatemala, in Mexico, in Honduras, and also in Dominican Republic. We have some connection there as well. And of course, we have dreams and hopes that someday we'll go to South America as well. And I was so glad to hear that they have interest in somewhat participating in Holiness Convention and also in Peru. But the reason why I'm here, because I want to let you know that the church in Latin America, I believe that what I'm calling it, the rise of the holiness movement in Latin America. My friends, God is not done with the church. And sometimes here in America, we have heard many times in the past that the holiness movement is dead. I'm here to tell you tonight that the holiness movement is not dead. It is quite alive everywhere. God is moving, and I want us to be a part of what God is doing. And I believe it is happening in Latin America. And we are creating a platform for the holiness message to be preached, to encourage pastor, and to help them. And within this platform, we have four words that we're working and developing: the word unity, the word holiness, the word family, and the word prayer. And that is where we're focusing on for the last 3 years. Our first convention in present was in Guatemala City. We just celebrated our third convention. And yes, it's not as big as we would like to see it. But our first convention, we had over 400 people. And last one, 350. This last year, just in March, just a few weeks ago, we had our convention in Guatemala. Now we had a convention in Honduras in the month of January in San Luis, Santa Barbara. We had a convention last year, September, in Mexico. And we are going back to these countries every year with holiness convention. And so we are excited about what God is doing, because I do believe that as a result of bringing the holiness Spanish churches together, not only overseas, but here in the United States as well. Right within HIM alone, we have over 22 Spanish holiness churches in this country, and we want to bring them together to have a holiness convention here in the U.S. as well. And we do believe that as we bring them together here and we bring them together in Latin America, we will see a holiness convention together in Latin America going forward, taking the gospel of Jesus Christ and the message of holiness. And we believe that as we look at this from a unified purpose, we have also the word holiness. Every year we have a different theme. This year we focus on the family. And as a result of that, last year we had a young Honduran pastor who was one of the preacher, and he preached the message of the family, because that is one of our core values. And it was the last message. We didn't have a lot of time for altar service and so forth, But the pastors and their family that were there on their way back home to their different fields of service, they were talking about this message and realizing that the family in Latin America is needing help. And so these pastors and these mothers, husband and wife together, discovered that their home needs help. And all of a sudden, there were brokenness and a spirit of revival in the van as they would go back to their different field of service. And this last March, our theme was the family, and God blessed. It was the second night God spoke, and the altar was just packed with husband and wife holding hand and kids just reconciling and seeking more of God. What I'm saying is, holiness is, yes, is what we call unity, but also the message of what we heard this afternoon of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and helping people to know that they can be saved and delivered from sin. And Latin America has a great challenge because the culture of Latin America is very charismatic, and I say that very carefully. And we don't have a lot of holiness resources and a lot of holiness known evangelists like we do in America. And our goal is to bring the holiness churches in Latin America together. It would be awesome if we have representation from all of these 800 churches in Latin America to let them know that they have brothers and sisters. They're not alone, as our brother mentioned here, because we believe that as we take this message and we share with them what God is doing in the ministry of holiness around the world, they can be a part of it as well. And then we have this last word, the word prayer. It is wonderful to see how God is calling Latin America to prayer. Actually, it's a wonderful thing. Our first convention, we had an all-night prayer meeting from 6 o'clock until 6 in the morning. Was beautiful. God bless. And as a result of that, God is blessing. And this last convention, these people said to me, we have to keep this up. We must keep this up. We're going back to our home churches, and we're not only coming as pastors, but we're going to hire buses and bring our people to this convention because this is what we need. And my friends, I closed this evening, let you know that the house is plentiful, 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 the house is plentiful,
the house is plentiful, the house is plentiful, the house is plentiful, the house is plentiful. Often in services like this, it can be easy to think, well, that's great for those missionaries, but what role am I supposed to play in the Great Commission? You see, not all of us are called to be cross-cultural missionaries, but each of us does have a responsibility to contribute somehow to the process of seeing disciples of Christ being formed among the nations. And sometimes that can be through unique methods and outreaches in ways that you least expect. Tonight I've asked two men to come share about a special harvest ministry, one in which every person here tonight in this auditorium can be involved.
My name is Joe Taylor, the director of Gospel Publishing Mission, which is Hope International Missions Department of Literature, Development, and Distribution. In the beginning was the Word and the Light. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never been able to put out the light. Friends, the harvest lies before us, and our work is to publish the light simply. We returned to Papua New Guinea in 1987. I knew the Lord wanted us to be involved in publishing. In praying about this call, the Lord brought to my mind a combination of things that I had learned about Voice of America's special English. This is a 1,500-word vocabulary of very simple words that was formulated by a major U.S. university. Even though some of the VOA staff was very skeptical at first, it quickly became some of their most popular broadcasting. I remember the Lord spoke to my heart. If special English is such a tremendous success to spread the world news, it'll be even more successful to publish the good news. And folks, from that moment, that has been our focus, to publish the light of Jesus Christ, simply. That was the genesis moment of this publishing ministry. Very quickly, the ministry spread from the jungles of Papua New Guinea to the far corners of the earth. We came to call this vocabulary International English. GoFest Missions Youth Conference in Nigeria was our first large event. We published 30,000 books for this Nigerian Youth Conference. The plan was for the 10,000 Nigerian students to receive three powerful books. The slogan for the conference was Kingdom Risk Takers. Before this event that seemed so large was complete, the Lord quietly spoke to my heart and said that soon this size of an event would seem to be small. And so it has happened. The next two projects totaled 350,000 copies of the book, Is God Really My Father?, distributed in war-torn Iraq. These were soon scattered across the Middle East by the refugees that fled the destruction of war. Then the Lord led us to hand out beautiful purpose-designed books for the two largest sporting events in the world, the Summer Olympics and the World Cup. These happen every 4 years, but one happens every 2 years. Dozens of projects around the world followed. There are books for disaster relief, for parades, for patriotic events, and can you imagine biker events? Only our God is so innovative as to gather hundreds of thousands of pre-Christians together in one place so that we can present to them the glorious gospel of Christ. Friends, God is moving in this troubled world. The fields are white, ready to harvest. Every one of us are called to be harvesters. Wherever we are, wherever God puts us, folks, are you willing to obey the Lord, but you don't know quite where to start? Let me give you about a clue about starting. Actually, two clues. Upcoming in the next few months, besides several bike rallies, is the Paris Summer Olympics, July 26th to August the 12th. And also, number two, a beautiful opportunity to present the gospel message to the 10 million people who attend a festival in Mexico City the first part of December. If you can smile and meet the requirements, we need you. If the Lord has sparked an interest in your heart, see one of us or scan the QR code on the Paris Project page in the convention magazine. If you are committed and sold out to send the light, we need you.
My name is Mark Sankey, and with my wife Melody, we have started a little organization called Oasis Ministries International, and we travel in full-time evangelism as well as short-term mission work, and we partner with various mission agencies, and one of those is Gospel Publishing Mission and Brother Joe Taylor. If you know Brother Taylor, you know he is a man of quiet but strong faith. And he is an inspiration to me and to many. My first real endeavor with Brother Joe was when he invited me to be a part of the London Summer Olympics. And by faith, he had printed 500,000 books for, I don't know, 40 or 50 people, at least from the U.S., to hand out. And we went over there, and he asked me to help lead one of the teams. And it was such a fantastic experience to be there with literally millions of people from all over the world and hand out these beautiful professional books that contain not only information about the Olympics, but a powerful gospel story. And I had such a wonderful time there. My faith was strengthened, and I was handing out books just as fast as I could hand them out, and people were taking them and smiling and saying, thank you, mate, and it was just wonderful. Had a great time, and we were there for a number of weeks, and just God helped and blessed, and with the help of many others, 500,000 of those books were handed out in London. And we had people coming up to us and saying, let me see this book that all of London is talking about. It was just so encouraging. And I came back home and I told Melody all about it. And she said, well, the next time Brother Joe does something like that, I want to go. And the next time he did something, we weren't able to go. And the next time we didn't have enough money. And the next time, you know, there was just scheduling things. But the time we were able to go together was... it wasn't London, it was Sturgis, South Dakota. And I don't know if you know what happens the first week of August in Sturgis, South Dakota. Sturgis is a town of, I think, 6,000 people, and between 500,000 and 750,000 bikers show up there every August, and they're not there for the purpose we are here for at IHC. So we wanted to go. Melody was excited. I was excited. We wanted to get out to Sturgis. And the first night that we were there, I think it was a Saturday night, and Melody stood on one corner and I stood on another, and we were close enough that we could have seen each other, but there were so many people. And I don't know, you don't have to believe this if you don't want to, but if there could be a picture right next to the dictionary definition of introvert, it would be my picture. I am I'm introverted to my core. I'm not naturally one of those people, believe it or not, that just enjoys getting out on the sidewalk and meeting people and talking to people. But I wanted to do this. I wanted to be involved. And so we got there, and I set up on my corner, and Melody was over there on her corner and started handing out these books. And I told Brother Joe at the end of that night when we got back together, I said, I think every biker that I saw was 6'8 and 350 pounds. I mean, they were just big, and they were mean looking, and sometimes they were a little bit mean and hostile. And you think you stick out like a sore thumb in Gatlinburg, just go to Sturgis. We stuck out. And, you know, it was a hostile environment. There were times when we really felt like, we weren't welcomed, and I would hand out books, and sometimes people would take them, and sometimes they wouldn't. And I'll be honest, I was intimidated, and I was a little discouraged, because it seemed like, you know, we sing, there's more with us than be with them, but it was the other way around there. And people kind of, they were drunk, and there was, you know, at not when I was there, but a couple days later, I guess there was some Hell's Angels and another gang fighting, and, you know, it's just one of those atmospheres. And I was on that street corner and just wondering why on earth, you know, the Lord would have called me to do something like this. I'm not making much of an impact. But then I thought about Melody. If I'm having problems, maybe I ought to go check on my wife. So I went over to her corner, and when I looked at her, she was had these big deer in the headlight look in her eyes. And when I came close to her, I said, how you doing? And she said, honey, this isn't like you said London was. And I said, honey, this ain't London. this is not even close. And she had her own stories, believe me, to tell of some of the things that people were saying and so on. But the Lord helped us. And we stayed at it, and day after day after day, we continued to hand out the gospel and smile at people. And when we began to drive away from Sturgis, South Dakota, on a Thursday, I believe it was, heading to our next meeting or wherever it was, when we started to drive away, I told Melody, I said, I don't know how to explain this, but my faith is so strong right now. And I'm not talking about the faith we use to pray, not intercessory faith, just my Christian faith, my walk with the Lord. I told her, I said, I just feel, I'm so strong right now in my faith. And she said, Mark, I feel the same way. Well, what was happening? Well, we were using spiritual muscle that unfortunately we don't exercise as much as we should, but our faith was so strengthened during those days. And we left that missionary endeavor strengthened with confidence to go back and do it again. And Jesus said Mark tells us in Mark chapter 3, that Jesus called his disciples. He appointed them to be with him and to preach the gospel and to have authority to cast out demons and to heal the sick. He appointed them first to intimacy with Him. He appointed them to be with Him. And then He appointed them to ministry. And then He appointed them to authority. And somebody's sitting here tonight thinking, well, I can't do that. I know God wants me to do things like that, and I have a desire to do things like that, but I can't do it. And maybe you've sat on that pew for too long thinking I'd like to, but I just don't think I have the power to do it, or whatever the excuse may be. But can I tell you, you will not experience the power and authority to do what God has called you to do until you take the step of obedience and do exactly what He's called you to do. I didn't feel like I had that in me either, but when I took the step of faith and obedience to get on that sidewalk and start handing out those books, even in a hostile environment, God gave me the power to do what He had called me to do. And He strengthened my faith in the process. And listen, who knows the seeds that have been planted? Who knows the reaping of the harvest, not only in this life, but in eternity? Could I tell you tonight that there's an open door for every single person in this room to step through, because God is calling us to reach the world around us in the shadow of our steeple. You don't have to go around the world, just right around where you are, there are people that are hungry for the message of the gospel that we have today. And so I urge you, walk through that open door.
Resisting all the changes that days and years can bring. When God decides to lead you through an open door, inviting you to walk in realms you've never known.
Fresh anointing, hear the Spirit.
said, "Look, lift up your eyes. See that the fields are white already for harvest." Ladies and gentlemen, the harvest is all around us. What are the doors God has opened for you, right in front of you? The eternal destiny of souls can be altered for the positive based on how we respond to the opportunities before us. Yes, we need workers. We need committed cross-cultural missionaries. But the Holy Spirit is wanting each one of us to walk on through the doors and to see a harvest of souls won for Jesus. I'd like you to join me in singing this chorus that Jeffrey is playing right now and prayerfully mean it from your heart. Lord, wherever you lead me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him, with him. Oh, Lord, would you stand with me and sing it one more time? Consecration. I've asked Brother Will Byler to come lead us in a time of prayer briefly for harvest workers. You've heard how God is working in the harvest. Tonight I praise him for that. But not only did Jesus tell his followers to look on the whitened harvest fields, he gave us a specific, special prayer request to pray the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Would you join us in praying tonight for laborers? God is calling. The harvest is plenteous. Perhaps he wants you to be a missionary or a full-time minister tonight, but undoubtedly, he does want each one of us to walk through the open doors to share the gospel with the lost. Pray with Brother Byler as he leads us.
We heard about the fields that are ripened to harvest tonight and the laborers that are needed. Could we lift our voices together tonight, asking the Lord of the harvest to raise up and send forth laborers into the harvest to reap the fields that are truly ripened, whitened unto harvest. Let's lift our voices together tonight to the Lord of the harvest, asking him, oh God, we call upon you in the name of Jesus tonight. No merits of our own, but the very blood of Jesus Christ and all that he has provided, truly the solution to sin. Lord, we have the good news. We have the gospel. Oh God, Lord of the harvest, we pray, raise up and send forth laborers and reapers into the fields. This is the will of God, that none should perish, but all should come to salvation. Help us as a people, O God. Help us, Lord God, we pray. Move upon our hearts. Fill us with the Holy Ghost. Make us a witness and a testimony with the power of God burning in each one of us. We call to you, O God, tonight in the name of Jesus. In this day, in this generation which we live, that you would send forth laborers and reapers into the fields. Lord, your will be done. This is your will. Move upon our hearts in this convention. Call forth men and women. Empower them with the Holy Ghost. With a clear and clear calling, we ask. We'll give you the glory. It's to the glory and honor of Jesus Christ. And for the will of God, we pray. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated as we conclude this service tonight. I want to leave you with some words from missionary John Payton. a life God used to reach the Hebrides Islands in the 1800s. I'm challenged and moved by the passion he had to reach the lost. Though he experienced intense difficulties, including the loss of his wife and child, his number one priority remained the proclamation and building of Christ's kingdom in the islands. Finally, after decades of committed service, God broke through and salvation came to the people. Nearing the end of his earthly journey, Peyton wrote, "Oh, that I had my life to begin again. I would consecrate it anew to Jesus and seeking the conversion of the remaining cannibals on the New Hebrides. My heart bleeds for the heathen, and I long to see a teacher for every tribe and a missionary for every island. Those poor, degraded souls are part of the Redeemer's inheritance given to him in the Father's eternal covenant, and thousands of them are destined through us to sing his praise in the glory and the joy of heaven. Don't rest. Don't rest. Not until every people, every language, and every nation has the light of Jesus shining in their midst. The harvest tonight is ready. The harvest is plentiful, and the harvest is precious. Each of us has a role to play in reaping this harvest. And whether he asks you to go or stay, don't settle for a life of convenience and ease. Walk through the open doors, knowing that the Lord will go before you. May God give us his passion for the lost. May we not rest until all have been given a chance to hear and respond to the gospel. The harvest won't wait until we have the time. The harvest is not ready 4 months from now. The harvest is ready today. Thank you for being here tonight. We thank you and we welcome you to continue to worship God as we transition to the next service. The Allegheny College Wesleyan Choir is coming to the platform to sing for us tonight. While they do that, let's just sing this chorus one more time, "Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow." Would you do that as they come? And let's just join together and sing, "Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow." Where He leads me, I will follow.
What would I do?